Our weekly press briefing. Let me begin with Prime Minister Imran Khan's address to the 75th session of the UN General Assembly on 25th of September. In his address, the Prime Minister shared Pakistan's perspective on all major regional and international issues, including COVID-19 pandemic, Prime Minister's debt relief initiative for developing countries, Jammu and Kashmir dispute, treatment of minorities in India, Palestine issue, Afghanistan peace process, illicit financial flows, climate change, Islamophobia, and the United Nations reforms. The Prime Minister also made specific recommendations on all of these issues. On debt relief, the Prime Minister underscored the need for additional debt relief measures for the developing countries. He called for creation of at least $500 billion in new special drawing rights and reallocation of unutilized SDRs to the developing countries. On illicit financial flows, the Prime Minister called upon the General Assembly to take the lead in efforts to build a global framework to stem the illicit financial flows and ensure speedy repatriation of stolen wealth. On climate change, the Prime Minister emphasized that commitments made through the Paris Agreement must be fulfilled. In particular, the commitment to mobilize $100 billion annually as climate finance. Regarding Islamophobia, the Prime Minister reiterated that willful provocation and incitement to hate and violence must be universally outlawed. He called for the UN General Assembly to declare an international day to combat Islamophobia and build a coalition to end this scourge from the world. Once again, raising the Jammu and Kashmir dispute, the Prime Minister drew the world community's attention towards continuing military siege, extrajudicial killings, incarceration of Kashmiri leadership and youth, collective punishments, use of pellet guns, and restrictions on all fundamental freedoms of the Kashmiri people. The Prime Minister particularly highlighted the reprehensible Indian efforts to illegally alter the demographic structure of the IAOJK through distribution of fake domicile certificates to the non-Kashmiris in clear violation of the 4th Geneva Convention. He called upon the Security Council to ensure urgent implementation of its own resolutions and take appropriate enforcement actions to grant the Kashmiri people their inalienable right to self-determination. The Prime Minister underscored that there can be no durable peace and stability in South Asia until the Jammu and Kashmir dispute is resolved on the basis of international legitimacy. Chairman of the High Council for National Reconciliation of Afghanistan, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah, paid an official visit to Pakistan from 28th to 30th of September 2020. Dr. Abdullah was accompanied by a high-level delegation, including prominent members of the High Council for National Reconciliation of Afghanistan. During his visit, Dr. Abdullah called on the Prime Minister, the President, and held meetings with the Chairman, Senate, Speaker, National Assembly, Foreign Minister, and other dignitaries. In his meetings, Dr. Abdullah, the Prime Minister reiterated his long-standing position that there is no military solution to the conflict in Afghanistan, and that a political solution is the only way forward. Commending the start of the intra-Afghan negotiations in Doha on 12th of September, the Prime Minister expressed the hope that Afghan leadership would seize the historic opportunity to work together constructively and secure inclusive, broad-based, and comprehensive political settlement. The Prime Minister also underscored that all Afghan parties must work together for reduction in violence, leading to ceasefire and conveyed that Pakistan would support whatever the Afghans agree upon about the future of their country. He further reaffirmed Pakistan's full support to the post-conflict Afghanistan on its path to reconstruction and economic development. During his meetings, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah appreciated Pakistan's critical role in facilitating the Afghan peace process and thanked Pakistan for hosting millions of Afghan refugees. He also reaffirmed the Afghan government and Afghan people's commitment to further strengthen relations with Pakistan in all areas of cooperation. Let me also share with you Pakistan's deep concern over the deterioration and the security situation in Nagorno-Karabakh region. The intensive shelling by the Armenian forces on civilian population of Azerbaijan villages is reprehensible and most unfortunate. Pakistan stands with the brotherly nation of Azerbaijan and supports its right to self-defense. We support Azerbaijan's position on Nagorno-Karabakh, which is in line with the several unanimously adopted UN Security Council resolutions. Since we've been receiving many queries regarding the extension of Saudi visas known as ICAMAs, let me also update you in this regard. As you all know, the ICAMAs of many Pakistanis expired on the 30th of September 2020. To extend full support to such Pakistanis, the Foreign Office took up the matter with the Saudi authorities, both for extension of ICAMAs as well as for additional flights from Pakistan to Saudi Arabia. The Saudi authorities have now confirmed to us that ICAMA holders can get their ICAMAs extended even from the embassy of Saudi Arabia in Islamabad. They need to fulfill requirements including approval of their kafils, both in case of private persons and companies. If the kafil is a company, then company will channel ICAMA extension request to the Saudi Embassy Islamabad through the Saudi Foreign Office. And in case the kafil is a private person, ICAMAs can be extended through an online website called Abshar, A-B-S-H-A-R. The Saudi authorities have also cleared 47 out of the 118 PIA flights for the month of October 2020. The clearance of remaining flights is also under process. Now coming to the Indian illegally occupied Jammu and Kashmir, the situation continues to deteriorate for 423 days since India's illegal and unilateral actions of 5th August 2019. In brazen manifestation of state terrorism, Indian occupation forces martyred another six innocent Kashmiris in fake encounters and so-called cordon and search operations in Anantnag and Pulwama during the past week. Another voice critical of Indian illegal actions and brutalization of Kashmiris was silenced when Kashmiri lawyer and activist Advocate Babur Qadri was shot dead by unidentified attackers in Srinagar. Pakistan strongly condemns and seeks independent investigation into the gruesome killings of innocent Kashmiris, including Advocate Qadri. India's efforts to subjugate Kashmiri people through killings, torture, forced disappearances, incarcerations, brutalization and collective punishments have failed in the past and will not succeed in future as well. By now, India must have realized that the resolve of the Kashmiri people is stronger than the Indian occupation forces, and the sound of the Kashmiri silence is louder than the gunshots fired upon them. On its part, Pakistan will continue to call for holding India accountable for its crimes against the Kashmiri people. In attempts to divert attention, India continues to escalate tensions along the line of control. the recent unprovoked ceasefire violations by India on 24th, 28th and 30th of September have resulted in one shahadat and serious injuries to seven. This year, India has committed 2,404 ceasefire violations, resulting in 19 shahadats and serious injuries to 192 innocent civilians. As part of Pakistan's efforts to keep the UN Security Council and the Secretary General apprised of the grave situation in IIOJK, as well as the peace and security in South Asia, the Foreign Minister has addressed another letter to the Council President. In his letter, the Foreign Minister has highlighted the gross and systematic violations of human rights in IIOJK, India's measures to change the demographic structure of the occupied territory, and the threat to peace and security posed by India's belligerent rhetoric and actions. You must have also seen reports regarding recent crackdown against Amnesty International by Indian government. It is another manifestation of India's extremist agenda and inability to hear truths from independent human rights organizations. The BJP regime's action has once again relieved the true face of India to the world. Today, the so-called largest democracy in the world stands fully exposed. I would leave it to the conscience of the world community to find a description that more aptly describes today's India under its current political leadership. Yesterday's flawed decision by the special CBI court in India in the Babri Masjid demolition case is yet another manifestation of permeation of extremist Hindutva ideology in all state institutions of India. Pakistan strongly condemns the shameful acquittal of all 32 criminals responsible for demolishing the centuries-old Babri Masjid in Ayodhya in 1992. The planned judiciary's decision is a sad reminder of the fact that under the fascist BJP-RSS regime, extremist Hindutva ideology takes precedence over all principles of justice and international norms. Pakistan urges the government of India to ensure safety, security, and protection of minorities, particularly Muslims, and their places of worship, and other Islamic sites on which the Hindu extremists and zealots have laid unfounded claims. I thank you all, and I'm happy to take any question on these.